So we're very pleased to have Melanie Wood from Harvard University. She's speaking on the average size of three torsion in class groups of two extensions.
All right, thank you for having me. So let's see. So I have the chat window open, but I might not necessarily be looking at it the whole time. If anyone has a question, please just unmute yourself and jump in with a question. I'm very happy to answer questions at any time. I want to make sure that what I say is understandable. So yeah, this talk is about joint work with Robert Lemke Oliver and Julia Wei. And the focus of our work is on the question, how big can the L torsion in the class group of a number field be? So say K is the number field of degree N. And especially, in particular, on average, we're gonna care about, in particular, on average. But before we get to that, let's just consider how big can the L torsion in the class group be? What do we know? So there is a conjecture. Due to Broomer and Silverman in 96, and also has been conjectured several times independently by other folks, that the size of the L torsion in the class group is bounded by the size of the discriminant to the epsilon for any epsilon. So this is big O, and the constant, you know, may depend on N, and of course depends on epsilon. But that in particular, the L torsion in the class group should be very small. So that's what we expect conjecturally, that this L torsion in the class group is very small. So, however, on the other hand, what do we know is generally much less. So the Brouwer-Siegel theorem tells us that the size of the whole class group times the regulator is about discriminant to the 1/2. So
I have a question.
Yes.
Is the L fixed here and the discriminant of K going to?
Yeah, that's a great, great question. I should say here, let's see, L is a fixed prime. Yeah, so I should, L was so fixed, I didn't even think to mention that here. So I guess I should put it in here that L and N, the degree of the number field we are thinking of is fixed, but K, the discriminant of K, is going to infinity. Great question, thank you. Yeah, so Brouwer-Siegel tells us that the size of the class group times the regulator is about discriminant to the 1/2, so plus or minus epsilon. Okay, I'm gonna get, I've already gotten kind of lazy here putting my subscripts on my less than sign. So this means that these are within a constant factor, but the constant factor can depend on N, the degree of the number field, and epsilon as can this constant factor. And the regulator, we have a lower bound for the regulator, which in particular, this implies that the size of the whole class group is bounded by discriminant decay to the 1/2 plus epsilon. And, you know, we know, for example, when K is imaginary quadratic and there's no regulator, that this is, you know, this bound, you know, up to constants, right, is tight, but the class group can really get this large, discriminant K to the 1/2. This conjecture says, well, the class group may be large. The L torsion for any particular fixed prime L should be a much smaller, you know, a very small piece of the class group. And so this leads to what is generally called the trivial bound on the L torsion. That the size of the L torsion is, and here I suppose, you know, this doesn't depend on L, the constant here, discriminant of K to the 1/2. And so then in this terms, the conjecture here is about sort of getting rid of this 1/2 in the trivial bound. And there's, you know, in general, the trivial bound, in most general situation, the trivial bound is the best bound that we have, though there's been a lot of progress in the past couple decades for particular situations of beating the trivial bound, sometimes just by some very small fraction, shaving some small fraction off this 1/2. In this talk, I'm going to focus on what we expect this to look like, what we expect this to look like on average in some kind of average over the fields K, or sum over the fields K. And to make sense, for it to be more natural to put these Ks together, I'm going to filter by the Galois group of the Galois closure of the number fields. So it's very useful to have a notion here. I'm going to define the notion of a Galois closure group. Closure group of a number field K is a permutation group. So that means it's not just a group, but it's endowed with an action on a set. And it's the Galois group of the Galois closure over Q. So this is the Galois closure of K. So that, of course, has a Galois group. And it acting on the embeddings K into the Galois closure. Okay, so that for example, if K is a non-Galois cubic, the Galois closure group is S3 acting, you know, on three things as usual. So in this setting of number fields that not only have a fixed degree, but a fixed Galois closure group, there are conjectures of Cohen, Linster, and Martinet on the entire distribution of the class groups of such number fields. So Cohen, Linstra, Martinet have a conjecture on the distribution of the class groups of K, you know, or at least some parts of them, most parts of them, for, you know, K with a fixed L closure group Okay, and so let's, for permutation group gamma, let's let E gamma of X be the number fields with Galois closure group gamma and discriminant at most X. Okay. So we're going to let X go to infinity so we can see all the number fields at once with some particular Galois closure group. And if we do this, then the conjecture, I'll say, you know, from the Cohen-Lenstra-Martinet heuristics is that for L, a prime not dividing gamma, not dividing the order of gamma, that the average here, so if we let X go to infinity and we average over these extensions with Galois closure group gamma, so now I'm averaging over these extensions. So I sum over each extension, I divide by the total number of extensions, and I take the size of the L torsion in the class group. So that this is actually equal to a constant. So, all right. So this is in fact even stronger than saying that the L torsion should be, you know, at most, you know, pointwise discriminant of K to the epsilon. I guess these should have been absolute value signs here. It's saying it's on average constant, not at least on average, not growing with the discriminant of K. So it's possible that there could be, you know, certain exceptional fields where where it's growing, but they have to be rare enough that on average one gets some constant value. So this indeed says that we expect this L torsion to be very small. Okay, so I'm gonna try to do that wasn't what I wanted. Trying to do the iPad version here of like moving one board, and here we go. So now we can still have that board and we have a new clean board here. All right, so in this average version, here, maybe just I'll call it star. So star has been known previously in very few cases, only in the cases of quadratic extensions and L equals 3. And that's by Davenport and Heilbronn in 71. I've stated things over Q, over an arbitrary number field. That's Skofsky and Wright also proved the analog of this result for three torsion and quadratic fields. And then for non-Galois cubics and L equals 2 torsion and non-Galois cubics by Bhargava in 05, though an astute listener might note that 2 actually divides the order of S3. So this is quite a case of the conjecture exactly, but indeed the result is known. This is a, sort of a long complicated story of, you know, whether Cohen and Martinet in particular wanted to conjecture the L equals 2 case for S3 or not. They you know, originally had some conjecture, and then based on the data, they wrote some paper, some good primes are not so good, talking about L equals two in the S3 case. So it's a matter of some debate whether one might consider this properly, you know, part of the conjecture, but whether or not it's part of the conjecture, it's a theorem. So that's better than being part of the conjecture. Okay, so.
Yeah, but at least in this case, L is co-prime to right. The degree
so
of.
The point is, of course, to try to find an efficient, easy way to do it.
Is that right?
Yeah, I heard something else. I don't know if that was just background noise, but Charlie, yes, at least it's certainly L is co-prime to the degree. So maybe you might think maybe that's enough. Yeah.
Also, when you write this constant, you also have this mm-hmm. little k. What exactly is that?
Oh, sorry. I think that I wrote that little k under some. That was in my notes under some version that I was going to write it over an arbitrary base, and then I decided not to. Yeah. So that was a little k where I was replacing q with good question. A number field, little k. So the conjecture applies over an arbitrary base as well, and I just decided to. Leave that out for simplicity. And so our theorem is that when gamma is a two group containing a transposition, so a permutation two group, so that it is containing a transposition makes sense. So for example, D4 acting on four things. So and L equals three star is true. Okay, so for L equals three now any two group. This example here, just to be concrete about what, you know, what does it mean to have Galois closure group D4 acting on four things? These are the, you know, this is about quartic, you know, quartic D4 fields. So quartic fields whose Galois closure group is D4. That's just a sort of a small, I guess S2 is the smallest example, but it was already known in that case. We have quartic D4 fields and many, many more, you know, many in every degree that's a power of two. So it's a two group in the sense of a P group, meaning that the group has order a power of two. So in every degree that is a power of two, there are lots of these two groups. And yeah, and indeed our theorem is over an arbitrary base field as well, even though I'm only kind of stating things for now over Q. We prove this over an arbitrary base. So let me now say something about like, what is this containing a transposition? Why is that there? Or what does that mean? Why those two groups? If one wants to understand, the asymptotics of this average, in particular, you might think it could be relevant to understand the asymptotics of the number of extensions. And that is another, you know, topic under another conjecture in the area, which is called Mala's conjecture. And it predicts the asymptotics of E gamma x for all gamma. And in particular, if gamma contains a transposition, for example, like the symmetric groups themselves, which contain transpositions, then Mala's conjecture says that the number of extensions is asymptotic to some constant times x. If gamma does not contain a transposition, then Mala's conjecture implies that the number of gamma extensions is at most x to the 1 minus delta for, say, for some positive delta. I'm not going to get too worried about the exact exponent there, because the point of this is that at least conjecturally, the Galois groups that contain transpositions are the generic ones, the ones that if you look among, you know, say all fields of a given degree or something, then you would see those some positive proportion of the time. So in general, Mala's conjecture is open, but there are many cases of it that are known, and in particular, Mala's conjecture is known when gamma is a P group. So, in particular, you know, for any of these two groups that we're talking about, and it's known for Sn for n equals 2, 3, 4, 5. And so, for example, we do know that when looking at, say, quartic fields by discriminant, a positive proportion of quartic fields are D4 quartic fields, and a positive proportion of quartic fields are S4 quartic fields. And that's, like, if you've seen that before, that's a little bit of a surprise. If you think about counting polynomials, it's different, you know, 100% of them will be S4, but when we actually just count each field one time, a positive proportion of quartic fields are T4. All right, so that's kind of the role that this contains a transposition plays, is that we're talking about the two group extensions that are, in fact, a positive proportion we expect of fields of their degree. Now, we don't know that because we don't know the counts for the other Galois groups in that degree necessarily, when the degree is greater than 4, but that's, you know, that's what we expect. All right, so that's the statement of our result. And before I go into a little bit about how we get that, are there any questions? Okay, great. Well, if you have a question later, please just speak up. So my goal now is to outline the main ideas that go into the proof. So I'm not gonna give a technical argument, but I want to sort of explain what goes into it, and we'll also sort of give an outline of what some of the whole tools in the area are. A big tool in whenever one is counting asymptotics of something is to make them coefficients of a Dirichlet series and understand the analytic behavior of that Dirichlet series. We'll call this ideas in the proof. And one very powerful method that has been used in a lot of these counting questions that I've mentioned is here the Shintani zeta function. So let's let F be a number field. And we have this function C of f, and it's going to count something by their discriminant. It's going to count cubic cubic algebras over the ring of integers O of F. So by a cubic algebra, I mean locally free rank 3 OF module is what cubic means, and then it's just an algebra. And I want them to be non-degenerate, so I'm going to require that their discriminant is not zero. And then this is going to be a Dirichlet series counting functions for such objects. So I'll take the norm of their discriminant to the S in the denominator, and then I'm going to weight here by the number of automorphisms of the cubic algebra. So ignoring this automorphism factor, it's essentially a Dirichlet series for counting cubic algebras by discriminant. And so then by sort of general properties of Dirichlet series, if I wanted to know about the asymptotics of cubic algebras, I could look to ask about the rightmost pole and the residues of this function. So let me just explain briefly why cubic algebras have something to do with this this question, which was about three parts of class groups. So if I have a quadratic extension K over F, and then I have an unramified cyclic degree 3 extension. All right. So i.e. coming from the class group, i.e. you know, i.e. from the class group, well, I'd say three times the class group, since it's an unramified abelian extension, then then one can see from class field theory and the action of here, let me just, I'm just gonna, for now, I'm gonna make F equals Q for simplicity. So, okay, then M over Q turns out to be a Galois S3 extension. And so it has inside of it you know, cubic, some cubic K3 over Q. So this is this sort of relationship from class field theory where one can go from something that has to do with the three torsion in the class group, which is the same as the class group on three times the class group, to an unramified extension, which is an S3 extension, which inside of it has a cubic extension. And one can do a version of this more generally over an arbitrary field. You have to use the relative class group, and it's a little trickier, but this is kind of why now. And so then, you know, then a cubic, say a cubic extension will have a ring of integers, which will be a cubic algebra. But this doesn't count exactly, I just want to be clear, this doesn't count exactly cubic fields here. It doesn't count exactly the three torsion of the class group. It just counts something that includes some things that are related to three torsion in quadratic extensions. All right, and so this, so we use this And what's useful is that Shintani in 72 and Detskovsky and Wright understood the analytic behavior of this C of F, including finding a meromorphic continuation with poles at S equals 1 and S equals 5, 6, and a functional equation, not with itself, but with a sort of dual Dirichlet series that counts some other related arithmetic objects. Right, and so this, I mentioned that Detskovsky and Wright had proven over an arbitrary base, one of the known cases of these results that we're talking about. And they did this through using the Shintani zeta function. And so, all right. So this lets us, for a number field F, say something, about the average three torsion in K over F quadratic. I mean, that's exactly what Detskovsky and Wright did with their theory of the Shintani zeta function. And so for us, RK in these gamma extensions, because gamma contains a transposition, it turns out that implies they are themselves quadratic extensions. So they have index 2 subfields. And so the overall plan is to use a theory like this theory of the Shintani zeta functions to understand the average three torsion in the class group of quadratic extensions of some fixed F, and then sum that over F. So, okay, is to sum over F. And then use for each fixed F. Now, there are some small issues in this whole plan. There are some relatively small issues, like worrying about overcounting, or when you took the quadratic extension, are you sure it's a gamma extension, and some things like that. But those are, it turns out, not the hard part. So you can imagine that works out. So another way to say it, this sum somehow, it's I'll cleverly not put exactly the conditions we need on everything, but so we have some f's, and then we have some degree 2 k's over f's, and then that's the kind of idea here, the discriminant of k is most x. That's the idea, and for any particular f, we can understand this pretty well. And so the main challenge is to understand how this depends on F. And well, that's part of it. And the second thing, let me say, okay, and so also this, the Shintani zeta function lets you say for some fixed F, understand this very well when X gets large as X goes to infinity, you know, for a fixed F. However, in our problem, there are always going to be Fs that are quite large, where the discriminant of F itself is quite large compared to X. And then, so that's the other sort of big obstacle. Understand how this sum behaves in, you know, sort of shorter intervals, i.e. when X is not so large. Compared to the discriminant of F. All right, I'll just say kind of one more time, because if you fix F and you let X go to infinity, the theory is very good at understanding what the Shintani zeta function. It's very good at telling you what happens. And but if you don't let X go to infinity, then it's not so, you know, it's not as powerful. And here there will always be, you know, in our whole sum here, there might be some Fs for which, you know, compared to that F, like X isn't so large. Okay. All right. So what do we do? So for one, we developed the analytic theory of the Shintani zeta function and things like the convexity bounds that we know for it uniformly in F, so that we can understand so that we can understand the output of knowing the analytic behavior in a way that depends explicitly on the discriminant of F. Unfortunately, that is not good enough, and that dependence is not good enough to sort of overcome question or sort of problem two, the sort of short short intervals problem. For that, we have kind of two new ideas and things that we kind of have to inject to make this work. And I should say, our paper is now out on the archive. If you happen to look at that, I will just mention that what I'm calling short intervals in the talk are actually what we call medium or intermediate intervals in the paper, because there are some really short ones that are easy to take care of for another reason. So, okay, anyway, just to match up. But these hard ones, we actually call them like the medium or intermediate intervals in our paper. All right, and so for these, what I'm gonna keep calling here the short intervals, there's sort of two ranges where we have to make two separate arguments, because each argument kind of works one place but doesn't work the other. So say in the range where we're talking about fields where the discriminant of K is, say, just to give you a sense of what I'm talking about by these kind of intervals here. So let's just see. So if and the discriminant of K is kind of a little bit larger than the discriminant of F cubed, but you know, up to the discriminant of F to the sixth. So in some sense, you know, the discriminant of K and the discriminant of F are sort of quite comparable. And so the range of fields that were for a fixed F that we're considering over F is pretty small compared to the discriminant of F. Okay, we use what we call a strategy that we call propagation of orders. So back when I mentioned this Shintani zeta function, it counted all these things, all these orders, and only some of them were maximal orders, and those are the ones that seem to be related to the things that we wanted. And usually one just kind of, you know, accepts that and sieves out for the things that you want and gets rid of the things that you don't want. And our strategy in this sort of propagation of order strategy is actually to use those orders instead of sieving out the non-maximal orders, to use them to our advantage somehow. So we, and how will that go? So we actually want to count say, you know, maximal orders of discriminant at most X. All right. So if we if we count all the orders up to discriminant X, we'll get all the maximal ones and we'll have some non-maximal ones that are thrown in there, but we can sieve them out. But if instead, so usually one would count orders, you know, up to discriminant X and then sieve out and get the maximal one. So instead, we count, orders up, you know, up to discriminant Z times X. Okay, so what does this mean? This means that we're going to get some overcounting of our desired objects because our maximal orders of discriminant X, inside of them will be some non-maximal orders that will have discriminant. So each of our, you know, up to ZX. So remember, what we actually want to count are the maximal orders. So each maximal order, each of our desired things, each maximal order will contribute to this count with some multiplicity, which depends on Z, how much room we, you know, by what I mean by it will contribute, it will have inside of it non-maximal orders of discriminant up to ZX with some multiplicity, you know, which depends on Z and depends on the maximal order, but we're going to control this. So we will control this, in particular, give a lower bound for it. So now we're going to count all the orders up to discriminant Z times X. On the positive is that now we've counted the orders that we care about with some multiplicity that perhaps we can lower bound and then divide by. On the other hand, we now are including things like maximal orders of discriminant ZX that we didn't want at all. So it is not at all clear that this strategy is helpful in counting maximal orders. And in fact, in most ranges of discriminants, it is not helpful. However, in precisely this range of discriminants, it turns out that this strategy by to count maximal orders all right, so in exactly this range of sort of discriminants that we care about, this turns out to be useful turns out to help when we take Z to be about, say, the discriminant of F. Okay, so yeah, so I just want to say it's an idea that you could say, well, if I want upper bound on orders of discriminant up to X, I could say I could count all the orders up to discriminant ZX, and then I would know that each maximal one contributed some non-maximal orders and lower bound that and divide through. It's really not at all clear that is going to be helpful in any particular situation, and in most ranges it is not helpful, but it turns out to be exactly what we need in one range. So then what remains, then one sort of one range, where I'll just, the discriminant of K, say, is very close to the discriminant of F cubed. So I'll call it this. Remains in our argument. And in that range, we're very close to, the argument is very close to working with the analytic theory of the Shintani zeta function and what one can get from this propagation of orders, but it just doesn't work. So to sort of complete the argument, in this range, we need one little further savings, any savings at all. In particular, we need any savings off the trivial bound. So we need any savings off the trivial bound for, and here I'm gonna define the relative class group. So this is the kernel, say, of the class group. So remember, K over F is an extension, and so we have some norm map from K to F. And the kernel of that norm map, say, is the relative class group. And so, we're doing this proof for two extensions, the whole thing, there's an induction on the degree of the two extensions. And so F is a two extension, and we've proven the full strength of the result for F. And so one needs then on top of F, in this last case, some tiny sort of pointwise savings, off the trivial bound for this relative class group. And then if we could do that in this range, we can then leverage that to prove that these class groups are constant on average. And all right, so I mentioned the trivial bound for the whole class group. And it turns out that there is an analogous, as we kind of explain in our paper, sort of trivial bound for just this relative piece of the class group here. So I'll say what that is in our result. And I mentioned that there has been some industry of trying to like save a little bit off the trivial bound. And one of the most sort of powerful inputs in that whole industry is a result of Ellenberg and Venkatesh from 07. So Ellenberg, Venkatesh, 07 showed how to use the RKLOB class group and small lit primes to get a savings over the trivial bound in say L torsion in the class group. So now I said that was really hard to get that savings, and of course what that just reduces this to the hard problem of finding small split primes. So for example, if you're willing to take be conditional on GRH, and you have a good effective Shevatarev, then Ellenberg and Vegetesh's result will give you some small savings over the trivial bound for the L torsion of the class group. However, without effective Shevatarev, one generally can't find small split primes. And so in general, this is still open. So in our work, so we generalize this to a strategy that works. And this is actually, okay, I shouldn't interrupt myself. In the relative RK Lib class group, and we get the following theorem. Which is if n k over f n has m completely split primes, maybe I should say split completely primes of norm, at most discriminant of k to the delta for some small delta. So I think delta needs to be less than 1/2 or maybe 4L. Sorry, 1/4L. And then the degree of k over f minus 1. So okay, so some small delta. If you have M is the many split primes you're trying to find of small norm compared to the discriminant of K, then the L torsion in the relative class group gets some savings over. And you'll see here now, I'll write out what the trivial relative bound is. So you have the relative discriminant to the 1/2 plus epsilon, but then there's actually another term here, which is the discriminant of the base field to this degree minus 1/2 plus epsilon. Okay, so, all right, wait, that would be the trivial bound. But then
it's not showing up for some
reason. You lost me at P. This is like what happened before at the beginning of the talk. Let's see. I'll try.
Okay.
Help. All right. Well, let me try. I'm glad that it lasted. This is the exact same problem we had at the very beginning of the talk. I'm glad it didn't happen 10 times during the talk. Okay, oh, great, all right, you can see. All right, I've just written here. All right, I was almost finishing writing here, but I'll review. So this is in K over F, okay? And these are these small split primes that you're supposed to be finding, and they're of small norm. So some small power of the discriminant of K. So this is like how small the power has to be. And then you get a savings in the size of the relative class group, and this is the trivial bound for the size of the relative class group. I sort of mentioned that there was a trivial bound. This is what turns out to be the right notion of the trivial bound. So far, I've only written a trivial statement, but I'm going to add something involving the split primes in a second. And it has the relative discriminant to the 1/2 and the discriminant of F to some power. And then if you actually found those split primes, then you get to divide this by the number of split primes you found. And so if you found some power of the discriminant of K of them, you can maybe get some power savings there. So I will just conclude by saying, all right, I just said that was all well and good if you can find small split primes But how do we do that? So to find these small split primes on average to get on average savings over the trivial bound is a strategy that was used by in joint work of mine with Pierce and Turnage Butterball, where we proved Shevchatov, effective Shevchatov holds for most fields using zero density results for L functions. And so we use in this case, for this project, we use some zero density results of Lemke, Oliver, and Thorner. To find at least on average, small split primes, which allows us to use this theorem to get the savings we need, which on top of our induction is the last piece that we need in the argument. All right, so I will end there.
So thank you for your talk. Does anyone have any questions?
So you use this transposition to create this index two subfield F. But where do you exactly use its two group?
That's because if there's also an induction. So I talked about how we need this savings. So we're trying to understand this class group of, we have sort of say K, F, Q. I said we want some, like for example, this argument, I said, oh, we just need some little savings here, but we're assuming by induction that the average of the class groups in this part is already known to be constant. We need all this entire strength of that, and that we know inductively. So that's why we kind of can only build two groups.
So if I try to run this strategy for, let's say, biquadratic fields, so certainly I don't have a unique quadratic sub-extension, but I guess I can manipulate just like compare the two sub-discriminants, right? Maybe order them.
Mm-hmm.
And where does this argument crucially breaks down?
Yeah, I think part of what happens here in this setup is that for any particular F, there are a lot of Ks over that F that contribute. And in particular, each intermediate field F contributes a positive proportion to the resulting sums. And if you had, say, like a biquadratic field, that you could have some quadratic field F inside of there. But then because the Ks with any particular F become kind of thinner, the way that the exponents and the bounds bounds work out, doesn't work out. I mean, in principle, there's nothing that prevents you from trying this strategy. The question is only whether the numerics of the sort of input bounds that you have exponents that sort of work out. And in practice, what happens in this case is because biquadratic fields, because the k's with a given f kind of are a thinner family, what that means in terms of the exponents of the bounds we have is that the sum doesn't work. But it's not, yeah, it's not that with, you know, you could hope to have better input bounds to be able to do that case.
I see, thank you.
Are there any other questions? I have a question.
Mm-hmm.
So you're proving that the average L torsion is like a constant.
Mm-hmm.
That suggests that it's possible that a lot of these fields, there may be no L torsion at all. Can you say how often zero L torsion occurs?
That's actually a great question. So the Cohen-Lipscher-Martinet conjectures, in fact, like, you know, will predict some positive proportion of the time that there's no L torsion at all. And, you know, while this, you know, isn't going to give that proportion, depending on what the actual number is at the end, it's possible that it could tell you that some fields have no L torsion if it is, and three torsion here, I'm talking, you know, or our result is in three torsion. I haven't looked on whether, and it could depend on the, you know, on which Gower group, but I have not looked at that. That's a great question. We should check and see. It just depends on whether the average is small enough. Yeah.
All right, thank you. Does anyone else have any questions? All right, let's thank Melanie. And I'm gonna turn off the recording.